Just another day at the office.
Got interesting stuff going on. That's Andy Vence's. He's using a horizontal plyometrics machine. That means that he's jumping while laying down at a 4% incline. There's rubber bands attached, but very big, thick resistance bands that when you hook them all up, it gives you 650 pounds of resistance.
So he'll be able to dunk a basketball in no time?
Well, that's the idea. And then you see over here, we can also add both high oxygen and low oxygen while they do this. So, you know, box jumps and other stuff that Remy has them do enhances the development of fast twitch muscle fiber. And, you know, all this, when you do low exertion with high intensity, it increases the production of growth hormone or testosterone. So it has all sorts of positive benefits in terms of explosive speed and power for boxers.
What do you think of Conor McGregor announcing his retirement?
Well, he announces that, and then you hear, too, that there's some sort of alleged rape charge against him, too.
I've heard that since December, but...
So I don't know. I have seen what happens, and that saying that it's a lot easier to get on top than it is to stay on top. The guy's made over $100 million. How much above that number, we don't know, but that really can, you know, reduce a guy's hunger, so to speak. And... So he fought the guy that the Russian guy that's trained by my friend Javier Mendez at AKA
Khabib?
Yeah, who choked him out, and you know,
Nate really wants to fight Khabib. Nate's calling him out.
Well, hey, that if you want to step up, that's your guy. He's like the truth of the UFC, like Earl Spence is in boxing.
26-0 is hard in MMA.
So yeah, that was complete and total domination. So once you realize that you're no longer, you know, competing to prove that you're the GOAT or the greatest of all time, I think a number of things have caused McGregor's hunger to become less.
Have you had MMA fighters come to your train here yet?
We have. I'm not really an MMA fan, frankly. Josh Thompson, who was in the UFC and Bellator, and he's been here a few times training with Basil. And in the past, both Remy and I worked with Kyle Kingsbury, who was also a UFC fighter. So we've worked with some UFC fighters, and I've been to several events. But too much blood and guts for me.
It's boring,
when they get the guy down and elbow him in the face and blood pops out with his heartbeat, you can see it squirting out of the top of his head. One time I was sitting, you know, right next to the cage, and I saw this, and I said, it's just too gory for me. So I'm more of a boxing guy than an MMA guy.
Well, then I'm going to ask you. You have your saying, float like a butterfly, sting like a bee. Are there any saying on the planet, why that one?
Well, Muhammad Ali was my childhood hero. I'm going to be 69 years old. So I was 10 years old in 1960 when he won the gold medal. And then, thereafter, in 64... He fought for the title against Liston and Juan, and my dad took me to the fight, and I was there at closed circuit television at a movie theater at the time, and then the rematch, and then eventually later when I was like 15, 16, if you remember, he fought Henry Cooper from the UK, came out, and it said, I'm so fast that when I turn out the lights, I'm in bed before the lights go out. So, you know, he is the fact that he could walk the talk, and all this more and four and all the predictions and stuff that he made. You know, my dad didn't like him at all. He wanted to see somebody shut that loud mouth up. But as a young kid, I really liked all the smack talk and how confident
he
was.
Backed it up?
So I used to dream. I used to lay in my room and look at that poster and imagine that one day I'd be like Muhammad Ali.
And you're working with the modern day Muhammad Ali's, with the Mikey's, the Devin Haney's, a lot of the star, Andre Ward.
Yeah, it was. I played music. I started at 10 years old playing the guitar, and I played at the elementary school talent show, and the whole crowd cheered, and I thought, oh, I'm going to be a professional musician. This is way too cool. Then I also was a competed in what they called Field Day, which was like a mini Olympics. And so I had fifth grade and sixth grade, I won the most outstanding boy. And then I wanted to be a track guy, because it was, and then I competed all the way through 2 years of college in track. And I was carrying a full load at Fresno City College. And I had, I was on the track team, so I was competing in meets. And every night, six nights a week, I was playing in a nightclub. So I was doing everything, school, music,
and
track.
You were living life to the fullest, Victor, man.
Then I had to make a decision which way I was going to go, sports or music. And I got a job offer to move to Los Angeles and make a lot of what turned out to be a lot of money. At a very young age of 20 years old, we signed a record deal with Epic Records, which is the same label as Michael Jackson.
What was the name of the band?
It was called Pure Food and Drug Act.
Again?
Pure Food and Drug Act. And we had some very famous guys in the band at the time. And so we all got a big cash advance. I bought a house and a new car, you know, at a young age. And so from 20 until 33, I traveled as a musician. I made 17 albums or CDs, whatever you want to call them, during that 13-year period. And then that's when I switched over to playing, when I founded Balco in 1984 at 34 years old. And then that had a 20-year history, and of course now it's carried over to Snack. And so I've been in the sports performance industry since 1983. So how many ever years that is? 36 years.
So let me ask you this: who's the greatest athlete you ever worked with? That's just out of every sport—football, basketball, boxing—who is the? Would you say just stood out, just athletically, was just so gifted?
Probably Barry Bonds. And they consider the all-time home run record to be the most coveted record in all of sport. And because of all the distractions and everything that happened, if you remember, you take it easy, good to see you.
Thank you.
How are you?
There's Oscar.
How are you doing, Oscar?
You know, he broke the record right after the 9/11. And of course, the countdown, and of course, everybody was, you know, there was all sorts of discussion out there, people possibly targeting him while he was up to bat trying to break the record, and just all the pressure of breaking that record. And of course, he just boom, 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 you know. In fact, when he broke the record, he had 70 and 71 in the same game, so he broke it and went ahead, and then ended up with 73, and then went on to hit 762, which that record, which was once held by Babe Ruth, is considered the most coveted of all records. And what can you say? You know, he was playing in a different era than others like Babe Ruth or Willie Mays or Hank Aaron. Hank Aaron and Willie Mays have both admitted that they were using greenies or stimulants, which are very potent performance enhancing substances, especially over a 162 game season. So,
you know,
what I'm saying is Babe Ruth wasn't going up against Roger Clemens throwing 100 mile an hour stuff, and who knows what he may or may not have been doing. But, you know, I believe that Barry Bonds, that accomplishment, those two, and that many consider to be the all-time home run record. He because of his level of concentration, if you remember what happened after, they wouldn't even pitch to him. They'd just throw four balls to the outside and let him walk. His on-base percentage was so high that it was ridiculous. And at the end of this whole process, you know, they spent, they say, somewhere between $55 and $70 million on the Balco case. When I went in for the 4 months, at that time they announced on ABC Nightline News that they spent $13 million prosecuting me, which I went to a club fed where they were. It's a tough question, but in fact, I'll tell you an interesting story. A kid this morning, we received a baseball from a kid in Texas and asking me to sign a baseball.
Uh-huh.
And so I signed one of my business cards, Balco business cards, and we sent him an autographed baseball and one of my business cards back to Texas just today. So it's interesting that you asked that question.
Do you think Barry Bonds would ever be vindicated, that ever, like, let his record stand or not?
You mean, will he ever be allowed to be voted into the Hall of Fame? I think so. You know, back in the day when they pulled back the curtain on September 3rd, 2003 for Balco, people didn't recognize how widespread the use of PEDs was. Now here we are, how many ever years later, 16 years later, whatever it is, and I think people realize that at that time in Major League Baseball, there was no testing.
That's true. Okay?
So back when you look at these, some of these records, like the women's world record for 100 meters, FloJo, 10:49. Well, they tested you at the competition, but there was no out of competition testing.
So
you
can
use all the drugs you like, taper off a couple weeks before, show up and be a monster and destroy these records. And then now they make the modern day athletes compete against some of these records that we know are tainted. So it's a mess. I don't know how else to describe it, but people have to judge each individual athlete against others in their era.
Well, have you talked to Barry Bonds since? Have you met him, run into him?
No, as you might imagine, back when that all happened, legal counsel on both sides advised no communication. Because
but it's been 16 years.
Well, it's been, he moved to Los Angeles.
Yeah. Now I've seen him, I've run into him.
Now I hear that he moved back,
okay.
You know, and but I have not seen him, no.
He's a nice person when I met him.
I hear he's into bike riding now. He weighs like 185. His girlfriend is an excellent cyclist. So he's and I do think that the Giants have embraced him now. He's
good.
Now got some formal capacity with them. Good for him.
Yeah.
You know, he was singled out. And just like Marion Jones was for female track athletes.
Oh, they went hard at her.
Others that were in that 100-meter final with her were not subjected to the same standard that she was.
Why? Is it racial?
Well, because the feds can get your emails and phone records, and if you lie under a penalty of perjury, you know, where these other girls that were in the final, there was no standard other than that they didn't test positive at the games. So, you know, I believe that the overwhelming majority, if not all of those that competed against her, were also using PEDs.
All right, Dr. Conte, always keeping it 100. I'm glad to see you're doing great. It's always good. Andy Vincent.
He's sucking up that oxygen, you see. He drains his tank and we fill it back up.